Welcome, this is Dr. Plague, and today I'm going to talk about something that I probably should have touched on in some previous videos. You see, I showed myself connecting up an FTDI cable to an AT-Mega-1284 without using any protection. This is what I did. I connected the UART transmit pin of the Mega-1284 to the receive pin on the FTDI cable, and connected the transmit pin from the FTDI cable to the receive pin on the Mega-1284. So, what do I mean by protection? Do we use latex? Of course not. I guess we could take this out of its package, unroll it, stick the chip inside of it, and then tie it shut. That would probably protect the chip. But if I start carrying my chips around like that, people would think I'm nuts.
And you think people don't already think you're nuts?
Well, I guess you have a point there. But anyway, that's not the type of protection I'm talking about here. I'm also not referring to ESD protection, although you could certainly look into protection for that. What I am referring to is something a little bit different. Now, you might think we're fine to connect the FTDI directly to the AT-Mega I/O pins. After all, it does state that in the FTDI datasheet. But I think what they're referring to is a special case in which you power the microcontroller from the FTDI voltage source. They do have a voltage output for powering external circuitry. But the problem is, some of these FTDI cables do not provide much current. For example, this one can only supply up to 75 milliamps. While this might be enough current to operate most microcontrollers, you may want to add some external circuitry that uses more current. For example, LS chips are current hogs. In any case, the problem comes when we try to power the AT-Mega from an external power source. If we look at the datasheet for the AT-Mega-1284, it states that the maximum voltage that can be applied to a pin is VCC plus 0.5 volts. So, what happens if we apply power to the FTDI cable before we apply power to the AT-Mega? Well, in this case, VCC on the AT-Mega is 0 volts, and the FTDI cable will output a high on its transmit pin, either 3.3 or 5 volts, depending on the cable. We're not supposed to apply more than VCC, in this case 0 volts, plus 0.5 volts. So we shouldn't be applying more than 0.5 volts to the AT-Mega pin. But the FTDI is applying at least 3.3 volts to this pin. By the way, the 3.3 volt version of this FTDI cable is 5 volt tolerant. So you can connect it up to a 5 volt circuit, which is exactly what I do since the cable I have is 3.3 volts. Now, we also have to look at the other direction. What if we power the AT-Mega before powering the FTDI cable? You could say the onus is upon FTDI to protect themselves, but that's not how I like to look at it. There was a frequently asked question on FTDI's website concerning applying voltages to their pins when the cable was unpowered. FTDI did state that applying a voltage to the pin of an unpowered cable will not damage it, but they did not recommend doing so. They mentioned that the cable would be partially powered by backfeeding it through the pin's protection diode. What they recommended was to use external buffers that allow signals without power present. Now, when I had connected the FTDI cable directly to the AT-Mega in a past video, you may have noticed that I cycled the power to the AT-Mega to reset it. But if you try that, you may notice that the AT-Mega doesn't reset. Because just like the FTDI, the AT-Mega will be phantom powered through its protection diode. In my case, since I'm using a 3.3 volt cable, the pin on the AT-Mega was only powered to 3.3 volts. And after the voltage drop across the protection diode, the AT-Mega was powered to a very low voltage. You may remember that I stated in a past video that I usually enable the brownout reset on AT-Megas using the fuse bits. And that's exactly what I did in that video. The phantom power from the FTDI was low enough to activate the brownout reset. But this is generally not a good way to solve this problem. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to place a buffer between the AT-Mega's transmit pin and the FTDI cable's receive pin. I'm going to use an open collector or open drain buffer. That way, the buffer output cannot go high without a pull-up resistor. There will be two power sources here, one from the AT Mega side and one from the FTDI side. I'll call the AT Mega power source VCCA and the FTDI power source VCCB. Now I'm going to power this buffer from the AT Mega side, which is VCCA. Then I'll add a pull-up resistor to the buffer's output. I'd recommend either 2.2K or 4.7K. The higher you go in resistance will decrease the current draw, but you may have issues with high-speed communications, so I'm going to choose 2.2K. Then I will power the pull-up from the FTDI side, VCCB. Now, I'll do the same thing to the FTDI's transmit pin, which is connected to the AT Mega's receive pin. But in this case, I'm going to power this buffer from the FTDI's source, VCCB. And I'll connect the pull-up to the AT Mega's source, VCCA. Let's look at how this will work. Let's say we power the FTDI cable before powering the AT Mega. This buffer will be powered up with a high on its input, but the pull-up will not be powered, so there will be 0 volts going into the AT Mega's receive pin. And this buffer will have its pull-up powered, but nothing will get through the buffer to the AT Mega, so the AT Mega's transmit pin will be held to 0 volts. So the AT Mega is protected from the FTDI cable. And likewise, if we power up the AT Mega first, then the FTDI cable will be protected from it. This buffer will not pass anything this way, and this buffer will not have its pull-up powered. So the FTDI side will all be 0 volts. So, what am I going to use for the buffers? Well, I happen to have these 7417 chips. You can also use 7407 chips, which should be the same with just a different voltage tolerance on its output. The 17 can handle 15 volts, and the 07 is 30 volts, which is way more than we need. The problem with these is that they each have 6 buffers, and we'll need 2 chips since they're both powered from a different source. So, we'll be wasting 10 buffers. This isn't too big of a problem if we're just messing around with hobby electronics, but I'm sure we could find some single buffer versions. We'll probably be out of luck if we're looking for dip or through-hole versions to use on a breadboard. But let's take a quick look on DigiKey. I'll look up buffers under Logic in the Integrated Circuits section. I'll select Active Status so we're not looking at any obsolete items. I want a single element, and I want open collector or open drain. Let's see, this one looks like an option. It's 3.3 or 5 volts. Its output can only handle up to 6.5 volts, but that's more than we need. And look at this. They specifically state that we can apply up to 6.5 volts on the output even if VCC is 0 volts. Fantastic! The package of this chip is quite small for hobby use, being that it is a 5-T SSOP. So, let's see if we can find something a little bigger. How about this SOT23-5? Let's check that data sheet. And again, it states that we can supply up to 6.5 volts in the power-off state, so that's perfect. And if we want to use these on a breadboard, you can purchase these adapter boards, which will accept a SOT23 package. And then you can just solder in some header pins, and then plug it into a breadboard. I think I'll buy some of these the next time I place a DigiKey order. For now, I'll use the parts that I have. And if we look back to the datasheet for the 7407 and 7417, it also states that we can apply the voltages to the output in the off state. So, no worries. We're good to go. So, let's connect up a couple of these 7417 chips, and here's the new schematic for this. Notice that I terminated all the unused inputs on the 7417s to ground. Don't just leave them floating. One thing to consider is to add a bypass capacitor on the power pins of the 7417s. A 0.1 microfarad to ground would be good. Even though I haven't added any, it is a good idea, and be sure to add them as close to the power pins as possible. And I'll use the same code that we left off on in the last video I made with the ATmega1284. This code just scans in and prints out a floating point number. So first, I'll plug in the FTDI cable and checking the voltage on the ATmega side, you'll see we're fine. Nothing above 0.5 volts. Then, I'll power the ATmega, and everything seems to work just fine. Then, I'll remove power from the ATmega and FTDI cable, and try powering the ATmega first. I'll check the voltages on the FTDI side, and we look good. Now, I'll power the FTDI, and just as before, everything seems to work fine. So, that's how I'm going to go about protecting the ATmega and FTDI cable from one another. I'm sure there are other solutions to this problem, and if you have any, then please share it in the comments. Well, that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time, right here on Dr. Play.